Well, good evening. I'm happy to welcome each of you. My name is John Merkel, and I direct the J. Phillips Center for Interfaith Learning, which is the sponsor for this evening's lecture. It's a delight to welcome each of you, and it's a wonderful pleasure to welcome back to our campus, because our guest speaker has been here before on a number of occasions, even as a scholar in residence at the Collegeville Institute for Ecumenical and Cultural Research, and I think a few of you out there may be there now. Sister Christine Athans, who has recently published the book In Quest of the Jewish Mary, The Mother of Jesus in History, Theology, and Spirituality. Sister Christine has been working in the area of Jewish-Christian relations for more than four decades. And in this book, she brings together her various specialties, that is, in history, she's a church historian, and theology, and spirituality. She has her PhD in historical theology from the Graduate Theological Union in Berkeley. And for a number of years, for many years, she taught at the School of Divinity at the St. Paul School of Divinity at the University of St. Thomas. And then after retirement, she returned to her hometown of Chicago, where they didn't let her retire. And she has been an adjunct professor at both Loyola University and the Catholic Theological Union. And since 2002, when she did return to Chicago, she has been an active member of the Catholic Jewish Scholars Dialogue of the Archdiocese of Chicago and the Chicago Board of Rabbis. Sister Christine, among her many contributions, was one of four scholars who contributed to the A&E biography production of Mary of Nazareth, which focused on the Jewishness of Mary. And she has many, many publications, and I'm just going to mention one very formidable book on Charles Coughlin, Father Dennis Fahey, and it's the Coughlin-Fahey connection, and it's on religious anti-Semitism in the United States between the years 1938 and 1954. And so it is a real special pleasure for me to welcome Sister Christine back to the College of St. Benedict, St. John's University community, and I know you want to join me in that welcoming. It's good to have you here.
He always likes to steal the mic, you know. Well, first of all, I'd like to say I'm delighted to be here. Actually, John and I have shared a podium on more than one occasion, and one time it was here, and another time at a big conference in Washington, D.C., and it's always a joy for me to be with him. And of course, I come from that other institution called University of St. Thomas down the road here. And on one occasion when I was a scholar in residence here, or whatever I was at the Ecumenical Institute, when I was coming out of Mass, you know how the organ is up there when you go to Mass during the week and people circle around the altar? There were steps there. I fell, and my glasses broke and dug into my, I had to go get stitches and under my eye, and I had this terrible black eye. And the very next day, we were having some kind of a special event for the theology department and the Ecumenical Institute, and here I am with this big black eye. Well, it so happened that the night before, St. John's and St. Thomas had played each other in basketball, and St. Thomas won. So I announced that the Johnnies were so angry when they came back that they beat me up, and that's how I got the black eye, but it really wasn't true. But at any rate, it has always been. We've all been related here in Minnesota, and it's always a very special occasion for me to come back here and to share. I'd like to begin, first of all, by also thanking John and Hans and all of the other wonderful people here and at St. Thomas for the welcome they have given me in these last few days. I'm often asked, how did I ever get into this topic in quest of the Jewish Mary? And I have to say that it all started many years ago in Phoenix, Arizona. I was a nice young nun, and we had just changed out of the habit not too long before. And I somehow or other got involved with this group of five Protestant churches, one large Roman Catholic Jesuit church, and two synagogues. And we formed a group called the North Phoenix Corporate Ministry. And in the fall of 1970, they had hired me to be the executive director of this group. So I lived at the convent. I had my office in a Protestant church. And a big part of my job was coordinating 25 wild priests, ministers, and rabbis, and the lay people of all these congregations as we worked together in education, social justice, liturgy, and communications. Well, I think back, and you know, it's kind of amazing when you're young and people ask you to do things, you think, oh, I could probably do that, you know, and you don't really realize what you're getting yourself into. But it was probably one of the most exciting professional experiences in my life. Now, I had preached sermons in Protestant churches and in Catholic churches, believe it or not, as early as 1968. But in the summer of 1970, I was invited to preach my very first sermon in a synagogue. And I'll never forget walking into that synagogue on this hot August night. And, you know, naive that I was in a yellow sleeveless dress with a little white Peter Pan collar and my nun pin, as the students often call this. And I got in there, and I'm standing, you know, in this hallway adjacent to what they call the sanctuary, and I realize I'd never been to a Shabbat service before. Not only had I never been to one, but I was oblivious of the fact that in many synagogues, women are supposed to cover their arms and cover their heads, sometimes with veils or hats. And I'm suddenly getting very, very nervous. Well, happily, this dear old retired rabbi came up and took me by the hand. And he said, I want you to know that the last time I was in Israel, I went to the synagogue in Capernaum where Jesus preached. And I want you to know how happy we are to have you with us tonight. And I let out a great sigh of relief. And I walked with the other rabbi, with the rabbis, into the bima, they call it. It would be what we would call the sanctuary, you know, where the Ark of the Covenant is. And suddenly, I'm listening to the rabbi, you know, read in Hebrew from the Torah scroll, and the cantor is chanting in Hebrew. And all of a sudden, I realized, this is how Jesus and Mary prayed when they lived on this earth. This is how they worshiped. And in some strange way, I almost felt closer to Christ in the synagogue than I did in some Christian churches I'd been in my lifetime. And I thought, this is a very enlightening opportunity. And somehow in my insides, I knew I somehow had to get inside of Judaism if I was ever going to understand Christianity, because Jesus was Jewish. And that was a really pivotal moment in my own spirituality, in my own life. And I think to this day how grateful I am that I had that time, that evening, in that very lovely place. Now, I have preached in many other synagogues. I have participated in every Jewish ceremonial you could imagine. And yet, that will still be the pivotal moment in my life. In the post-Vatican II period, there was a whole lot of conversation about the Jewishness of Jesus. But I have to admit that because I am a Sister of Charity of the Blessed Virgin Mary, I started to get interested in the Jewishness of Mary. And I ended up with about five questions that helped me to sort of frame this book. Now, I'm going to just read them all in a row right now. Then I'm going to take a little bit of time to discuss each of them. And then I want to close with a final meditation, which is part of the last chapter of my book. The first question is, why has Mary been portrayed as so un-Jewish over the centuries? Secondly, why are we searching for the Jewish Mary now rather than some years ago? Thirdly, has the search for the Jewish Jesus helped us to find the Jewish Mary? And lastly, how might Mary have prayed? Now, I have to say that to understand Mary's Jewishness, we almost also have to look at all the detours that were taken over the centuries in terms of how Mary was portrayed, and also the different, we're not going to go into all the doctrines and devotions about her, but two of the chapters in my book sort of look at this overview of Mary from a historical perspective, and also include the doctrine and the devotion. So one of the things I'm going to do is, where is my friend Hans? Is Hans here? Good, there's Hans. We are going to do this very quick PowerPoint presentation of Marian art through the centuries. It's important to note at the beginning that, you know, the Jews did not believe in trying to do portrayals of what they thought, you know, God looked like, or even some of their great holy people. And so we really do not have, until almost the fourth century, anything that we could begin to think of as a portrait or a painting or an icon of Mary or Jesus. And so I think that needs to be said from the very beginning. And I think we also need to know that some of the very first images of Mary are really come out of the Greek tradition. Those of you who are theology teachers or theology students may know that it isn't until the 4th and the 5th century that people are trying to discover what is the relationship of the divine and the human in Jesus. And if we more we try to find out about that, the more we start to question, well, who was his mother and how do we describe her? So I'm going to just do some very quick overview here of the different periods in church history and how Mary gets portrayed. So I say next and Hans clicks, and we've got this down to a system after Monday night at St. Thomas. So the patristic period is normally the period we think of between the 2nd and the 7th centuries. And next, this first icon, which is a little hard to see, actually is from a little town in Greece called Mystra, outside of Sparta, and it's the town where my father was born. I happen to be half Greek and half Irish. I think it's important to see, Mary looks like an empress, doesn't she? She has all these jewels on. And the other thing we're going to note in the couple of icons we look at is that Jesus never looks like a baby, does he? He looks like a little man, doesn't he? And that, of course, is to portray his importance and as, you know, wisdom coming from God the Father and so forth. But the last thing I would mention is these fathers of the church, as it were, almost look Asian, don't they? And it's interesting because we talk about the Eastern Orthodox churches as part of what we call the Oriental Church. And I often think when I look at those that there's more of a link there to the Orient than we would normally think. Next. Okay, this is an undated Greek icon. Once again, Jesus doesn't look very much like a baby at all, does he? And next is the famous Russian Our Lady of Vladimir, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with. And these images of Mary were more because at the Council of Ephesus, she was proclaimed Theotokos, God-bearer. So if she was a God-bearer, if she was somebody who was actually the mother of God, she couldn't just be a little peasant girl. She had to be regal, right? And that's where many of these icons come from. Next. So we move into the medieval period, which again is roughly the 5th to the 15th centuries or thereabouts. And next, what we begin to have is, this is a period where, you know, how many of you remember when you were in fifth grade, you had to make castles and moats, and you had lords and ladies, isn't that right, and vassals, and, you know, feudalism was the big deal, and so forth. Well, what happens, of course, in the Middle Ages is we also have the beginning of building these huge cathedrals in Mary's honor. This is Notre Dame in Paris. Next, this is the Cathedral of Cologne. Next, the wonderful cathedral in Milan in Italy. Next, and this is from the facade of the cathedral at Athans in France. And of course, it's supposed to be the flight into Egypt, and poor Jesus looks like he has his nose smashed in. Next, this is from the Benedictine monastery at Montserrat, where again, St. Ignatius of Loyola is supposed to have had his famous conversion experience and laid down his sword before that statue of Mary. Now, what you're going to start seeing is this: the next several statues, we have Mary holding an apple, and that's to indicate that she is, if you will, the new Eve. You know, if Eve was the reason why everybody went down the drain with sin, Mary was the one who redeemed, or was the mother of the Redeemer. Okay, so next, and here, this is a Bavarian. We still have Mary, the Queen of Heaven, right? But Mary holding the apple. Next. Now, in the Renaissance, there's this whole thrust about humanism. And this is where biology begins to come into the picture. We have anatomy being studied. And so we begin to have, shall we say, much more emphasis on the human body. Next. This is supposed to be the Visitation, where Mary greets Elizabeth. And these are women of some girth, would you say? Next. Here is a Rembrandt, Mary with the baby. Next. The flight into Egypt, another Rembrandt. Next. I always think that Jesus looks hungry here. But again, this very human piece of Mary. Next. And this is Raphael, and John the Baptist is part of this as well. Next, one of my very favorites, Michelangelo, where we have St. Anne, Mary, and the baby, grandma, mama, and the child. I think it's very special. Next, and there's probably nothing to compare with this magnificent statue of the Pietà. Michelangelo was only 26 years old when he carved that out of a hunk of marble. And I just think it's amazing. Next. Here we especially notice the muscles. You begin to get that human piece. Do you see what I'm trying to say? That became enormously important during the Renaissance period. Next. Here again we have Raphael, Sistine Madonna, and many of you are familiar with the little angels that appeared on all sorts of coffee cups and t-shirts and things during this period. Next, we have, this is El Greco's vision of Mary. And next, we begin into the pre-Vatican II period. Now, once we move through the Baroque period and we get into this pre-Vatican II, we start to study more about ethnicities. And there begins to be, especially in the 19th and the post-Enlightenment, but especially in the 19th century, a whole new emphasis on the superiority of the Nordic people, the Germanic. I mean, we have Wagner's operas, all this sort of thing. So Mary suddenly is not only a nice little Jewish girl, but she becomes next Mary with the long blonde curls and blue eyes. If any of you went to Catholic grade school, you probably had a statue of Mary peering down off of a pedestal, and oftentimes she did have fair hair, fair eyes, and she was squunching a snake with her heel. Next, here we have another Mary, Stella Maggiore, Star of the Morning. Next. This is a poem that many people in my generation learned in grade school, and some of you may still remember it. Lovely lady dressed in blue, teach me how to pray. God was just your little boy, tell me what to say. It was even set to a tune. And this was the devotionalism of the time. And every one of these was perfectly good in its own time and place. Do you see what I'm trying to say? But it moved, it changed. Next. Mary Immaculate became a great devotion in this period. Next. Our Lady of the Way, this was Madonna della Strada, is the large chapel at Loyola University, where I went as an undergrad. And I have to say, my theology always was, if I fell in the ditch, maybe Mary'd help me get out. Okay, next. The Sorrowful Mother was very popular, novena, during World War II, when women were losing their sons in the war. Next. And here was Our Lady of Fatima. This became very popular as an anti-communist prayer to save the world from the Russian communists. Next. And here we have the definition of the Assumption in 1950. Next. And now Vatican II and after. It's very interesting to see, I think, how there's a very just different emphasis that comes in to the church. Next, we begin to have this new emphasis on the cosmic Mary. Mary, who's sort of queen of the universe, but in a different sort of way than we're beginning to move into the time where people are circumnavigating the earth, John Glenn and all of the others, in their, whether it's Sputniks or whatever. Next. And here's another cosmic Mary. Next. And line drawings rather than those voluptuous Madonnas of the Renaissance. Next. Our Lady of Hope with the anchor, the symbol of hope. Next. Our Lady of the Blessed Sacrament with the bread. Next. And then we also get into these ethnic Marys. So here's the Asian, Japanese Mary. Next. This is a Native American Mary. Next. A Hispanic Mary. Next. And then there's also a new emphasis on doing wood carvings. Next. And that as well. Now, the next one, I think, is the Jewish Mary. But that, we're going to wait, okay? Because I want to... I guess what I'm hoping is that as a result of this particular piece, you are going to get an idea that visions of Mary have changed over the centuries. And each generation, each era had devotion to Mary in its own way, and every one of those was good. But the question then becomes, who was the real Mary? And I think it's important for us, I'm just going to say one thing here that might sound a little complicated, but in the 19th century particularly, what sort of fed this idea of the blonde, blue-eyed Mary was something which was known particularly and taught by Protestant scholars called the criterion of dissimilarity. They were of the belief that anything that Jesus had in common with the culture of his time really didn't count, because that isn't what made him unique. So we can toss that out the window. So his Jewish religion, his Jewish culture, that wasn't supposed to make a difference. Now, any of you who are studying psychology here know that that is hardly the case. Isn't it true that we are who we are because often of our particular ethnicity, of the family that we come to, whether we're a misunderstood middle child like I am, or whether we're in a particular, we grew up in the Middle West or up here in the tundra. We're all who we are because of the experiences we had, whether we went to kindergarten or took ballet or played football or whatever it happens to be. So we can't just disregard all of those things. And I think it's important for us to realize that in the 1940s, which I'm sure seems like a million years ago for many of you, some very important things happened. One, of course, was World War II and the Holocaust, which I'm sure you've heard of. And during those years, it was probably one of the most painful experiences in all of the history of humankind. I'm fond of using one quotation by saying, if Christians had really been Christians over the centuries, would the Holocaust have occurred? Because even though we can't you know, blame Christianity totally, there were so many things that led up to the fact that at the time of the Holocaust, many Christians did not speak out. And that is really painful for us to understand even today. But at the same time, some very good things did happen during the 1940s. One of them, for instance, was that Pope Pius XII reversed something. In the early 1900s, we had a whole crisis called the modernism crisis in the church. And during that time, Pope Pius X promulgated an encyclical called Pascendi Dominici Gregis. And at that time, he would not allow Catholic scripture scholars to use things like the historical critical methods. And therefore, Catholics were really, the Catholic biblical scholars went underground. And therefore, many of the people who helped to prepare for Vatican II, such as your own Godfrey Diekmann here, and others as well, they really weren't allowed to publish, to preach, to teach very important areas. But Pius XII came along in 1943, and he reversed that. He said Catholic scripture scholars could use historical critical methods, and that changed things enormously. Also, just a few years later, we have the discovery of the Dead Sea Scrolls. Now, how many of you have ever heard of the Dead Sea Scrolls? Okay, then you know it's all about the fact that some nice little shepherd boy was, you know, roaming around some caves near the Dead Sea, and he threw in a couple of rocks, and he could hear all this clinkety-clink, and he decided to go in there and see if there was something he maybe could sell, right? And he found these ancient scrolls, the oldest complete scroll of the prophet Isaiah that exists. I mean, this was just absolutely remarkable. And so what happens on the head of this is that Catholic, Protestant, and Jewish scholars start to come together to study these scrolls. And not only did they learn from each other, they kind of liked each other too. And they said, you know, we ought to continue working together. So the beginning of this wonderful dialogue on scripture scholarship and other areas really begins in the 1940s. Now, Vatican II, as you know, which is the years 1962 to 65, picks up with all this new exciting material that starts to be unearthed by scripture scholars, and they in turn decide that they are going to provide this material to the bishops at the council and see hopefully what can come of all of that. Now, I just want to do one little backtrack here, and that is there's this whole phenomenon in devotion to Mary in the post-World War I period. Now, we're talking here oh, roughly the years 1920 through the end of Vatican II or beyond even. Now, the bishops in the United States wrote a document at the end of World War I on Mary, and it referred to her as the perfect woman. And so, therefore, anybody who went to school, particularly Catholic schools, between 1920 and, I'd say, as close as late as 1970, they were always getting this image of Mary as this really perfect woman. She was so perfect, it was almost impossible to imitate her. For one thing, she was both a virgin and a mother, which was kind of hard to figure out, right? And then at the same time, she was she would never do anything that was askew, right? And so, now I've never heard this from a BVM nun, I want to say this, but I do know, I have heard that there were some girls, particularly in Catholic schools, who would hear things like, well, if Mary didn't chew gum, you shouldn't chew gum. Or if Mary didn't wear shorts, you shouldn't wear shorts. Well, I just have to say, because someone who grew up during that era, it was really gloomy. I mean, because here you, I mean, if you were thinking about going, you know, to a beer party and shorts and the back of a convertible and there was a beautiful moonlit night on a lake and a bonfire and all this, you know, that was not something you could envision Mary doing, right? So it was a real downer for your social life. So Mary was like the smartest kid in the class who never did anything wrong. And you know, how do we sometimes feel about the smartest kid in the class who never does anything wrong, you know? So the result of the situation was women in this period often had kind of a love-hate relationship with Mary. She was like this magnificent woman who had so fascinated God that he made her his mother. And I can remember one priest saying, you know, girl, you could fascinate him too. I mean, there was this beautiful love of Mary. But at the same time, you know, I will never forget my very favorite Jesuit saying to me one time, and I nearly killed him, saying, I never worry about a fellow if he's out with a good girl. Well, since when did the girl have to take all the responsibility for anything that went wrong in a relationship, right? So there was this, and I remember saying that to him. And even some liberal cardinals like Cardinal Sunens of Belgium said, you know, women have the awful responsibility of being either Eve or Mary. You know, they can either raise people up to heaven, raise the man up to heaven, or drag him down with them in their fall. You know, I just, this was too much for me. So anyway, I raise this up because, how many of you are familiar with the fact that there are some feminists, particularly, who have a hard time with Mary? And one of the things that seems to be responsible for that attitude was this idea that Mary was indeed presented as a very passive figure, that Mary was indeed someone who, you know, found herself, was a model that they found it very hard to identify with. Now, this is my theory. With Vatican II, we have two documents that come out. One of them is called Nostra Aetate, and it's the declaration of the relationship of the church to non-Christian religions. And it has a very important statement, Article 4, on Jewish-Christian relations. And it's the first time, really, that the church opens up to the relationship with Jews. Another document from Vatican II is called Lumen Gentium, the dogmatic constitution on the church. The big fight among the bishops, not that there's anything new about fighting among bishops, that's been going on for many years, but seriously, the big argument was, do we do a special separate document on Mary, or do we include Mary in the document on the church? And after a very, very close vote, 1,000 and some on one side, 1,000 and some on the other, only 40 votes to bear. And they instead decided to keep Mary in the Constitution on the church, because they said Mary too had to be redeemed. As all of us had to have been redeemed, she is indeed, we are part of this church that she is part of. And that was a very, very important conclusion. Now, interestingly, both of these things were happening at the same time as something that was called second wave feminism. This is a version of feminism that arrived at this particular time. And I do believe that there were people who wanted to show, if we could put it that way, that Mary didn't have to be presented only as a passive figure, that Mary perhaps could be a more assertive figure. Now, when I was first appointed to teach on the faculty at the St. Paul Seminary School of Divinity of the University of St. Thomas, I was invited to be one of the founding mothers of a group called Feminists in Faith. We were Catholic, Protestant, and Jewish women, all of whom were very committed to our religious traditions, and also very concerned that the role of women was not being appreciated in our religious traditions. I might add that within a few years, we had Muslim women in our group as well. And this became a very interesting phenomenon, because what we discovered was Mary, who was revered by Christians, especially Catholics, and also by Muslims. Are you aware of the fact that Mary is mentioned more in the Quran than she is in the New Testament? That's something that a lot of people aren't aware of. But what do you know? This Mary, who is revered by Christians and Muslims, she's a nice little Jewish girl. And that was made very clear. I'll never forget when we had a clergy meeting at the Conservative Synagogue, and every week we would meet on Fridays for lunch and conversation and fun and food. And the one particular time we were in this Conservative Synagogue, our topic was Mary. And the Catholics and the Protestants were fighting like dogs back and forth. And the Protestants were saying to the Catholics, you know, you just divinize Mary. You make her more important than Jesus. And the Catholics are saying to the Protestants, well, the only time you dig her out is for Christmas cards, you know. And finally, one of the rabbis said, I don't know what you're all upset about. She was a nice little Jewish girl, you know. And that brought us back home again to the beginning, if you will. And a very, very important piece. So I'm of the conclusion that this Feminist in Faith group was just one more effort on the part of many women who were very committed to their religious traditions, but who wanted to look for a Mary who could in some way relate to the contemporary Mary of our era and not be just some shy, passive figure. Now, the third question is, has the search for the Jewish Jesus helped us to find the Jewish Mary? Now, in the post-Vatican II period, one of the big questions was, will the real Jesus please stand up? And, you know, people started looking at that question. What happened, I think, particularly among scholars, was as they discovered this Jewish Jesus, they also discovered a document known as the Mishnah. Now, the Mishnah is sort of the foundational document of the Talmud, which is a recording, if you will, of the oral tradition, mostly from the first century when Jesus and Mary would have lived. Sort of like if you're familiar with how the New Testament was put together, we know that it didn't get put into writing until the end of the century, right? Many years after Jesus actually died. Now, to explain my backdoor approach to all of this, I have to tell you that for years I have been fascinated with the Pharisees. And I discovered this new understanding of the Pharisees over the years. And, you know, despite all the harsh things we read about the Pharisees in the New Testament, Jesus really had more in common with the Pharisees than he did with any of the other groups, the Sadducees, the Essenes, the Zealots. And I might add, the Christians were one more group under this kind of umbrella of Judaism. And so, and not just so you think this wasn't just my idea, if you read church documents, particularly in 1985, there's a whole Vatican document on notes on the correct way of teaching about Jews and Judaism in preaching and catechesis. In all of these documents, we find the church saying, yes, Jesus had more in common with the Pharisees than he did with others. Just one quick aside, and how many of you know in the last political presidential election, anybody remember any of those Republican primary debates where you had Romney and you had Santorum and you had, who were some of the others, Newt Gingrich, and you remember the whole bunch? Did they get along very well together? Did they have huge fights back and forth with each other? Almost worse than some of the ones between the Republicans and Obama, you know, at that particular time. Now, the point I want to get at is sometimes you can be within the same group, isn't that right, and have more arguments among yourselves. So there are those, think of Joseph of Arimathea was a Pharisee. Nicodemus was a Pharisee. So Jesus had a lot in common with the Pharisees. I'm not going to go into detail on any of this, but I just want to mention about five things where, if you have a chance to read my book, you can read about it in detail. First of all, the Pharisees, who later become known as the rabbis, always address their leader as rabbi. And how many of you remember in the New Testament that Jesus is called rabbi? Does anybody recall episodes like that? Okay, they pray in the synagogue. Now, as long as the temple is still standing, they surely go to the temple as well. But basically, they find their prayer life in the synagogue. They believe very strongly in table fellowship. They refer to God as Abba, Father. They have strong belief in doing mitzvah. Mitzvah is living out the life of the law, if you will, but the law in the broadest sense of the word. And they indeed also believe in what was called the oral Torah. And probably the most important thing is they believed in the resurrection of the body. The Pharisees, as opposed to the Sadducees, believed that the holiness of the temple extended beyond the priests to the Jewish people. So therefore, and this is kind of interesting to me, it was the privilege of the people, not just the priests, to obey all 613 commandments. Now, most of us have a hard enough time with 10, right? But 613, but they said, no, why should the priests be the only ones who can do this? In other words, what we sometimes think of as legalism among the Pharisees really was a kind of egalitarianism. It was this idea sort of the priesthood of the laity. See, we all have this kind of right to do these things. And the theological underpinning of this was what was sometimes known as the interiority of covenant. They believed we should have a kind of intimacy with God, that God's individual love for each human being was so great that it would last even beyond death. They prayed to God, Avinu Shebashamayim, our Father who art in heaven. Now this led me to ask, can the Pharisees tell us anything about Mary? Now, this gets very complicated, so I'm not going to go into detail with it you at the present time. But let me just mention that there used to be, you know, there still are archaeologists, aren't they, who go to the Holy Land and dig up all these old synagogues. And, If they found the name of a woman, they would think, oh, she must be the wife of a rabbi, right? That's the only reason they'd mention her. Well, new scholarship now is telling us that no, perhaps some of these women played an important leadership role in their own right. So there's a lot of research that's being done on what is called Second Temple Judaism, which is the first century when Jesus and Mary lived, up through the destruction of the temple in the year 70. And more there are examples of women who did important things. And I think the important thing to do is realize that the women who followed Jesus, who were part of what was called, I would call, the early Christian movement, it wasn't yet a church, actually, they were Jewish women. They were observant Jews. So Mary, Mary Magdalene, Martha, Mary, the women we read about, they were Jewish women who observed the law. And one day I was up in the library at Loyola University in Chicago, and I found what I consider to be the smoking gun in a volume entitled On the Cutting Edge, The Study of Women in Biblical Worlds. I found an essay by an Israeli woman scholar from Hebrew University. Her name is Tal Ilan. And she thinks she can prove there were probably women in the Pharisees. She does this very intricate rabbinic analysis, and she goes on to talk about how, and particularly Paul, who claims he was a Pharisee. How many of you remember that Paul talks about being a member of the Pharisees? He was of the tribe of Benjamin and all this kind of thing. Well, that Paul probably carried over some of his Pharisaic ideas into Christianity once he accepted Jesus. And again, I'm not going to even touch all the complicated ways in which she tries to discuss this, but I think it's worth looking at, and it's worth our knowing that part of this is clearly what we're looking at and referring to today. Now, I want to be very, very clear on one thing. I am not saying that Jesus, Mary, Joseph, Mary Magdalene, Peter, James, John, that any of them were card-carrying Pharisees, okay? But I am saying that they probably were closer to the Pharisees than any of the other groups of their time. And if that is the case, then the more we study about the Pharisees, the more we can learn how they might have prayed and what were some of the rituals in which they found themselves participating. And much more research on this needs to be done, but it is kind of a fascinating way to think maybe we'll learn more about Mary if we go this route. So my last point is, how might Mary have prayed? Too often, Christians have forgotten that Mary was a faithful, prayerful, observant Jewish woman. Although she was very probably illiterate, she likely knew many portions of the Torah, especially the Psalms, by heart. We can presume, I think, that Mary would have known the watchword of the Jewish faith, Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. When she sat down to eat a meal with Jesus and Joseph and whoever else was there, she would have started her prayer as we began our little dinner tonight before, as a small group of us gathered before, by saying the prayer over the bread, which is sometimes known as the motzi. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, hamotzi lechem min haaretz. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has given us the bread from the earth. And we could have done the one over the wine too. Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam, borei pri hagofen. Also, you know, when Elizabeth and Mary meet, Elizabeth pours forth her Kaddish, which is a prayer of praise hallowing God. And it's very similar to the Canticle of Hannah from the first book of Samuel. Mary and Joseph participated in rites of Jewish ritual purification. You know, we all know that they presented Jesus in the temple according to Jewish law. Mary would have gone to the mikveh, the ritual bath with the other women for their monthly purification. Joseph and Jesus, when he was of age, and Mary, although women were not always required, would have fasted and prayed all day on Yom Kippur. A Jewish view of life is really holistic. There is a bracha, or a blessing in Judaism, for absolutely everything. How could Mary have lived otherwise? There's a famous Jewish scholar named David Flusser, and he says, Mary is a certain link between Jesus and the Jewish people. Now, there is a genre in rabbinic literature known as midrash. And it really means searching, inquiring, interpreting, elaborating. It's not just biblical exegesis. And it's an effort to make sense of a biblical text, often by development and elaboration. Some people think of the infancy narratives as midrash. Some people think of the parables as midrash. And I would just like to say in conclusion that I would like to share a midrash with you. I have learned many prayers in Hebrew since that very first time I preached in the synagogue. One of my all-time favorites is a Hebrew prayer called the Shehekianu. And it goes, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Shehekianu v'hi imanu v'hi hiyanu lazman hazeh. And what it means is, blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has given us life and sustained us and brought us to this very special moment. Now, they say this, you know, either in the temple or in family gatherings for bar and bat mitzvahs, for birthdays, for weddings, you name it. Somebody will say at some point, do you think we should say a Shehekianu? And everybody will sing or pray that prayer. Now, about a dozen years ago, I decided to make a 36-day retreat out at the Jesuit Retreat House in California. Most of my friends thought I could never keep quiet for 36 days. So, you have to know what St. Ignatius says, even in this Benedictine environment. especially when you're meditating on the life of Christ, he suggests that you put yourself into the scene and that you be one of the participants somehow, or at least a bystander, so that you can sort of enter more deeply into the spirituality of that scripture. So when I was meditating on the birth of Jesus, I decided to be the innkeeper's wife, and I could then be attentive to Mary's needs. So in due time, the shepherds came, and they just thought he was a beautiful baby. And there was this ethereal music, and the innkeeper and his wife were very excited about everything that was happening. And eventually, the shepherds left, and the angels evaporated, and the innkeeper and his wife went inside. And I had this vision of Joseph and Mary sort of snuggling down in the straw with this brand new baby in between them. And in the back of my head, I said, what might Mary have said to Joseph at that moment? And all I could think of was, maybe she said, Joseph, do you think we should say a Shehekianu? And together they would pray, Baruch atah Adonai Eloheinu melech haolam Shehekianu v'kihimanu v'hihianu lazman hazeh. Blessed are you, O Lord our God, ruler of the universe, who has given us life and sustained us and brought us to this very special moment. Now, I shared this reflection with an Orthodox rabbi friend of mine, and he brightened up and he said, but that's right. If you have a girl, you say a different prayer. But if you have a boy, you say a Shehekianu. And he said, I can't prove it's from the first century, but it's very, very old. And I found out it is indeed referenced in the Mishnah. And so just maybe, that was the prayer that Mary and Joseph might have said the night Jesus was born. So too often we have tried to transfer our prayers to Mary instead of inquiring as to how she might have prayed. I love the story of can't remember whether it was a cartoon or a painter, but they had Mary, you know, in prayer and contemplation, waiting for the angel Gabriel to come and tell her she's going to be the mother of Jesus, and she's saying the rosary, you know, which we know doesn't come into existence until the Middle Ages, you know. So we have kind of tried to give our prayers to Mary instead of asking Mary, perhaps, to give her prayers to us. So I continue to the quest. It certainly hasn't been concluded with my book, but by meditating on the scripture, exploring the role of women in Second Temple Judaism, and learning more about Jewish prayer and ritual in Mary's time. And it seems to me that if we do that, hopefully we can come to better know this Jewish woman who can be a source of strength and courage for women and men in our new millennium. Now, what I want us to do, and I have just not too many more moments, and I'm always afraid to ask John what the time limit is, but at any rate, hang in with me just a little while longer. Next, okay, this is a sketch of what I think of as a Jewish Mary. It's by a Dutch artist named Rian Portvliet, and it's from a book called He Was One of Us. And what I'm going to ask you to do at this point is either focus on this picture or close your eyes, and I'm going to go over here on the side, and I am going to read a meditation of the Annunciation and the Visitation. And it's going to be an abbreviated view because I was told I was too long the last time. But I'm hoping that you will perhaps get a sense of how I have envisioned Mary reflecting on her life and her challenges in this very important time. And then after that, we're going to see a few more quick sketches from this book, and then I'd be glad to take any questions and also hear any reflections from any of you in the group. Okay? We all set here? Excuse me. When I was about 14 years old, I was living with my extended family in a small village of Nazareth in the Galilee during the Roman occupation. I was grateful to be with extended family and friendly neighbors and kept busy carrying out household tasks. I was betrothed to a wonderful young man named Joseph, a carpenter. He was such a good person and eager to prepare a home for us. It promised to be a happy marriage. One day, I encountered a very powerful invitation from a mysterious figure. I must have looked frightened, and at first I was afraid. This extraordinary being who was enshrined in light appeared to be from heaven and said, "Do not be afraid, Mary." I remembered the words of the prophet Isaiah, "Say to those who are frightened, be strong, fear not. Here is your God. He comes to save you. The apparition seemed very gentle, kind, and comforting. I came to believe it was of God. Then I heard an extraordinary statement. Behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall name him Jesus. I could hardly believe it. I had not had sexual relations with Joseph. How could it be? So I did a very Jewish thing. I asked questions. I was young, but not naive. I asked the heavenly creature, how can this be, since I have had no relations with a man? The apparition replied, the Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be holy. He will be called Son of God. I felt a little like Jeremiah. I wanted to complain to God that I was too young, only a child. How could I take on such responsibility? But at the same time, I felt overwhelmed by love. Somehow deep inside, I felt engulfed in a call so strong that I could not turn away, could not not say yes. It was as if I had a new inner knowledge of God in the intimacy of my heart. I knew that God was calling me, inviting me to belong to him in a way I could never have imagined. How could I not say yes? The only clue I received from the heavenly creature was about my dear cousin Elizabeth. She was much older than I and said that she had never had a child, but I learned she was also pregnant and in her sixth month, because nothing is impossible with God. I was so happy for her. Although I was concerned as to how Joseph would understand all of this, I wanted to be the servant of the Lord and to trust always in God's love. I accepted God's invitation to be the mother of the Son of God. Elizabeth had always been a special person in my life. I knew she would need me. I convinced my family and Joseph that I should go to her. I could join a caravan from Galilee to Jerusalem. Zechariah could meet me there and take me to the hillside village of Ein Kerem to help Elizabeth prepare for the coming of her baby. Finally, they agreed. At first, I was lonely on the trip. I recalled that Esther, who was a great leader of our people, had been frightened and lonely too. She had prayed, my Lord, our King, you alone are God. Help me who am alone and have no help but you, for I am taking my life in my hands. As I traveled along, I came to realize that my willingness to say yes to God's plan was grounded in my deep conviction of the faithfulness of God. I have prayed the Shema twice each day, and sometimes more since I was old enough to do so. Shema Israel, Adonai Eloheinu, Adonai Echad. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. I always continued with the scripture passage I love so well. V'ahavta et Adonai Elohecha. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. Take to heart these words with which I charge you this day. You shall teach them diligently to your children and recite them when you stay at home and when you are away. As I recited the words on my journey, I knew I would indeed teach those very words to my son. A child is growing within me, and it is all very mysterious, but I want to share that love with the whole world. For some unexplainable reason, I have been chosen by God for a special mission, and I know only one thing. I can trust him to the end. To see Zechariah waiting for me in Jerusalem was reassuring. He took me up the hillside, burgeoning with spring flowers, to Elizabeth in Ein Kerem. When I saw her radiant face and her open arms, I ran to her, buried my head in her warm bosom, and wept. There was so much joy and fear pent up inside of me these last weeks. She was almost like a mother god who enfolded me in her arms. Elizabeth, now 6 months pregnant, experienced the child in her womb leaping for joy. It was as if our two children were speaking to each other. Then Elizabeth said, "Blessed is the fruit of your womb." It was the confirmation I needed to realize that this child I would bring into the world was indeed a holy one of God. How does one spill out the joy and the gratitude that is in one's heart with such an extraordinary realization? I remembered Hannah, who in a moment of joy poured forth her Kaddish. "My heart exalts in the Lord. My strength is exalted in my God." The Kaddish sometimes concludes with a prayer for peace. Oseh shalom bimromav. Uya aseh shalom aleinu v'alkov Yisrael v'imru amen. May the Lord give strength to his people. May the Lord bless his people with peace. I asked God for peace for my people and for the whole world. I asked God for peace in my heart as well. In the months ahead, that prayer song echoed in my heart. Oseh shalom bimromav, uyaseh shalom aleinu, ve'al kol Yisrael, v'imru, imru amen. Yaseh shalom, Yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu, v'alkov Yisrael. Yaseh shalom, Yaseh shalom, shalom aleinu, v'alkov Yisrael. Amen. Now, I have to show you just this last couple of slides. So, next. This is the young Mary meeting Elizabeth, and I swear she looks like Elizabeth has her hands up, and she's saying, Mazel Tov. Congratulations. This wonderful thing is happening to both of us. Next. This is Mary on the donkey heading for Bethlehem. I'm sure it could not have been a very comfortable place to be on when you're 9 months pregnant, right? Next. This is Mary and Joseph in the stable. Next. And here are the shepherds coming to see the new baby. Next. And I think this is a wonderful slide of Mary feeding the child up on the left and Jesus with a little dog or somebody in the right, and Joseph playing with him, and Jesus with his kippah, his little skull cap on, down in the right. Next. And this is Mary when she finds Jesus in the temple. Remember when he stayed afterwards and put them all through grief looking for him for 3 days? Okay, next. And this is John the Baptist and Jesus at the baptism. And next is taking down Jesus from the cross. And the last one for now is called Our Lady of Zion. You know, it's important to realize that if you had one Jewish grandparent, you could go to the ovens during World War II. And so certainly both Jesus and Mary would have qualified. So there's Mary with the Star of David and Jesus in Mary's heart, but wearing his prayer shawl and such. There's one last one, which is sometimes I find interesting, although it's not totally Jewish, it does have that element of it. And I think Mary is a special person to both the fathers and mothers of both the Hebrew scriptures and the Christian scriptures. So thank you very much. I appreciate your patience with me as I coughed through a few of these prayers.